Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Be seated. We have been working our way all through Easter, but especially through these past 2 weeks up to this point. So 2 weeks ago, we talked about dwelling places, how dwelling places are connected often to places in this earthly realm that have been significant to us, but that they go beyond that. And when Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you, and in my Father's house there are many dwelling places, it's not a physical place in heaven that is a recreation of a physical place on earth, but instead is that place within us that we go to dwell and to find rest and re-energize ourselves. And then last week we took it a little bit further. And we listened as Jesus said, I abide in you, and you abide in me. And this word abide continues with this idea of the dwelling places, and how not only are there places in which our souls dwell and find comfort, but that all of those places, we bring Christ and God. We bring all of that with us. When our souls enter into those dwelling places, God is there within us and us within God. And all of this was Jesus's final goodbye to his disciples. This is now, we had gone back in time a little bit in our Easter season to before the crucifixion, when Jesus was preparing his friends for his death. What that does for us today is reminds us of this whole journey through the Easter season that these disciples are on. This 50 days from resurrection to ascension, which is what we celebrate today. Ascension happened, Jesus is ascending into heaven for that final time, happened on Thursday. But we celebrate it today because we didn't have an ascension service. So we're talking about it in this space. And remembering that this is a huge period of transition. If you ever want to talk about transition, this is the time. We have been spending time with Jesus' disciples throughout Easter, seeing the resurrection appear. what those appearances really mean. And now is the day where it all comes together. And there's a really important piece of this, which is why I had Dan read a couple extra verses. And that is, as Jesus has been making these appearances all through the past 50 days, he's been teaching and revealing himself and reminding, giving those final explanations to anyone who he appears to and who will listen. And he says, there's so much to be done, but wait. I am about to ascend to the Father. Wait in Jerusalem until the Spirit descends upon you. That is Jesus' final gift, this final promise that he has, the descending of the Spirit, which we'll talk about next week. But that command to wait is so important. And I imagine that that Jesus' friends had some mixed feelings about this. We know that they were an exuberant group of people, especially Peter, remembering when he didn't want his feet washed, and then Jesus gave a little explanation about why he needed them washed, and he said, okay, well, don't just wash my feet, wash my head and my hands as well. Or the time when Peter's in the boat half-clothed and sees Jesus and gets so excited that he jumps into the water. Our disciple friends want to act. They see Jesus, they hear Jesus, and they are ready to go. They want to do it. They want to be part of it. On the other hand, post-crucifixion, they're also really afraid. They're locking themselves in rooms. They aren't sure what the wider community is going to say or do to them. And so they hide away a little bit. So maybe this command to wait is a relief, or maybe it is anxiety-producing because all they want to do is get going. But wherever they land, Jesus says, wait, just a few days. Think of a time in your life when you have been told to wait. What has that waiting done for you? Was it agonizing? Were you just ready to go and had to be held back? What happened when you were held back? Was it perhaps a relief and you would have waited for decades? What happened when you finally did what you were waiting to do? These are the questions that we wrestle with today as we too wait for the descending of the Holy Spirit, for Pentecost Sunday, the birthday of the church as we know it today. We don't get to do it in a few minutes. We don't get to do Pentecost Sunday tomorrow. We have 7 days where we are told to wait with the disciples. 7 days may feel like an eternity, or it may feel like the blink of an eye. The reason that we have been spending time, especially these past 2 weeks, talking about dwelling and abiding is in preparation for the command to wait. Because we aren't waiting and twiddling our thumbs. We are waiting in that dwelling place, where God abides within us. We are prayerfully anticipating the command to go when the Spirit descends. That is the kind of waiting that the disciples were told to enter into, and it's the kind of waiting that we enter into ourselves. There is a risk, always, in waiting, because you can wait too long. Remember a couple months ago, we were talking about Martin Luther letter to a Birmingham jail where he says, "Now you cannot wait any longer. We can wait too long to act. But if we go too soon, we can act without thought. We can act without prayer. We can act without the Spirit. Figure out for yourselves in this next week what God is asking you to do, what you are waiting for in order to be able to do it. And remember that next Sunday, the Holy Spirit descends. And if that's scary, look around. We are a community, just as the early church was a community. Jesus was not speaking to Peter alone. He was speaking to 12 individuals and then some. We are never called to act as individuals, but we lean on one another. We look to one another to help us figure out what and when and how. Take courage from the fact that you are not alone. Take a deep breath.